And good day. Welcome to the Microsoft Virtual Academy. My name is Ed Bott. I'm going to be your host all day long today as we do a Windows 8.1 jumpstart. I've been working with Windows for, gosh, nearly 20 years now. And Windows 8.1 came out last month. And two things struck me as I was learning about Windows 8.1. Number one is how quickly it appeared, almost exactly 1 year after Windows 8. And the second thing is how much was in it. There's a lot of stuff in Windows 8.1. Don't let that 0.1 moniker fool you. This isn't just a service pack. There's a lot of things in here that are really important to the IT pros who are in our audience today. We're going to cover a lot of ground in five different sessions over the full day today. We're going to cover things like deployment, management, and mobility. But we're going to start with one of the things that's really near and dear to people who actually use Windows and the people who you support in your day-to-day jobs, and that's the user experience. With us right now is Ben Hunter, who is from the Windows team and runs the Springboard program. And if you're an IT pro and you're not familiar with Springboard, you should be. Ben, tell us a little something about the changes in the user experience for Windows 8.1.
Yeah, hi everyone. So what I'd like to start off with first is just a quick overview of Windows 8.1. Just really want to say that Windows 8.1 is still Windows. You still have all the management stuff you're used to, Config Manager, all the management abilities still there. You have group policy and so on. We then have the same sort of security kind of setting. So if you're wanting to secure down your OS, you want that strong OS that you could trust is not going to get malware and so on, that's there, and you can control these settings. And it's also reliable, like previous versions of Windows 7, Windows 8. That's all still there. But what I really want to dive into today is the user experience, that desktop experience, and the changes we've made based on your feedback.
That's an interesting word that you use there, Ben, feedback. I know Windows 8 came out roughly a year ago, and that first wave of Windows 8 users had a lot of feedback for Microsoft. So I know one of the things that people gave feedback about was the desktop experience and just getting to the desktop. So what's in Windows 8.1 for the people who had that feedback?
Yeah, let's have a quick look here. So we've done a couple of things around getting to the desktop. The first is allowing the users to boot to the desktop directly. So you don't come into Windows and log on and go straight to the start screen. Then the second part of that is we've configured it so you can only leave the desktop when you want to. So if you close your apps, for example, rather than going back to the start screen, it will come to the desktop. So what I'd like to do is maybe we can jump into a quick demo here and I'll show you how that's done.
Perfect.
Okay, I have a Surface Pro here that I will do these demos in, a Pro 2, great machine. Okay, so here I am at my machine. You can see here, there's the start screen. This is where you would normally have come to. On Windows 8, this is where you would land. Now, if we go through to the desktop here, what you can do, so we right-click down here, we select our properties, and go across to navigation. Now, there's a whole bunch of extra settings that you'll see here that weren't there previously on Windows 8.
In fact, that entire tab is new, isn't it?
Yeah, and part of what we're looking at is we really want you to be able to configure Windows to be the way you want it to be. So you can have the experience of using your start screen, getting to the desktop and so on as you want it. So let's have a look at a couple of the options here. So the first one I want to show you is showing the desktop first. So if we go, I'm getting myself lost here. So we boot to the desktop, we select the option here. When I sign in or close all apps, I'm selecting boot to desktop. So we select that option. Now when I close my apps or go to the start screen, so let's say I have an app here and I close this app, I pull it down and close it. Or we log in, it will go to the start screen. Now I made a mistake there, I didn't hit the apply button, which is obviously something you should really do. So we have that option there. Now the next thing I want to show you is some multi-monitor type support.
Okay, let me ask you one quick question before we go away from that. Is that a setting that you can apply by policy to your users so that they don't have to go find that setting on their own?
Yeah, definitely. Let's have a quick look in here at the at group policy. So I'm going to go in here and just bring up the local group policy editor. We'll make that a little bit bigger here. And I'm going to go into, there's two options here. So what I can do is on the user area, I can set boot to desktop. So if we go to, if we jump down here to, where is it? We are in Windows Components. And we go to Start Menu. It's down here. Oh, this is fun.
But what you've basically got here is an environment where you have a group of users that you're supporting.
Yep.
They're accustomed to working on the Windows 7 desktop.
Yep.
And all of a sudden, you've thrown them into a potentially unfamiliar environment. So using these group policy settings here, you can define it so they're less likely to be confused by that new transition, and
correct,
they're going to see the familiar desktop that they know how to navigate, they know where their apps are, they know how to manage the taskbar and so forth.
Yeah, that's correct.
Okay, great. So we've taken care of getting them to the desktop. Now, they're still going to see the start screen. That's going to be where they manage their programs and their pinned Internet Explorer tiles and so forth from, right?
Yes, exactly. So let's have a look at the start screen here. So this is the new start screen layout.
Okay, now I can already see one thing that any Windows 8 user will know is different, and that's that you have four different sizes of tiles instead of two.
Yeah, this reminds me of my Windows phone, personally. I've laid this out. This is my start screen.
Okay.
This is not the start screen that you're using. It's not the start screen that you out there may be using. I have some things that are important to me up here. I have my calendar. As you can see, it's my auntie's birthday today. I have other things, like I have my wife on there, so I can tell if I can get directly to my wife and see if she's done things with Facebook. I have my weather and places that are important to me. So, for example, Auckland. This is where I'm from. I'm a Kiwi. I want to feel jealous of the weather down there. At the moment, it's looking nice and warm. So I have that information, but also I can see Woodinville, and I have family in London as well. So I like to keep an eye on the weather around here and other places. But I've got my information here. So this is great. Now I can change start screen, these tile sizes if I want. So for example, if I've got the weather here, I hold that down, I can resize the tile.
Great.
So if I did, for example, wide, I'm gonna get less information here. Just like down here, I have this Auckland tile, it's less, but I can choose what I want to do there. Okay, so that's great. You can see I've done other things, like I've got my desktop icon large there in the middle here, which has got a picture of New Zealand on it, so I know where my desktop is and I can get to it quickly.
So this is a custom start screen. This
yep.
is one that you've done. Your individual users can customize their start screen too. Now, when they install a new app or when you push an app
yep.
to their workstation, that in Windows 8, that tile would have appeared on this customized start screen. In Windows
yep.
8.1, that doesn't happen. Where do their apps appear in Windows 8.1?
Yeah, one of the things we changed with 8.1 is, you know, with 8, if you installed Office, for example, or other apps, and you scrolled right off down here to the end of your start screen, there would be a whole bunch of icons, lots and lots of them. You know,
right.
you could fill up pages and pages of it. What we've decided to do in this new version is not drop the icons straight there, or not drop the tiles on, and let the user control the start screen. So the user can add the tiles themselves. They can add what they want and control it themselves, and it's not getting cluttered with all sorts of other tiles.
Now so, I see something else new on that screen as well,
yeah.
down in the lower left corner.
Yes. So now this is very important to the feeling of giving users control. Let's scroll up here. So what you'll see is we have the view of all apps. So we can see all the apps you've installed. If we go along here, you can see, and they're organized in different ways. So this one's by category. So you can see I've got social apps, photo apps, and so on. If I keep going here, you can see all the desktop apps that I have installed on this machine. Now, I have Office, Outlook, and so on. So if you wanted, you can set this up so users get this view by default. So
okay.
Now, we can configure this a little bit more. Let's have a look at some of the categories here. I can change this to date installed. So this to me actually isn't that useful other than when I install a new app and I'm not sure what their name was. Hopefully I would know what the name was, but sometimes I can't remember quite what it was called after I've installed it.
But it's going to bubble up to the top of this view.
But it will be right at the
top. Right.
So this might not be something you use all the time.
Right.
But it certainly is something that you might use occasionally. Okay, you've got most use. This is actually one that I prefer and usually what I leave it on. So the apps that I use all the time bubble up to the top. So we can also do it by name. So those are the four you see. Now what you can do is control this a little bit more as well. What we can do is set this up via group policy so the user can get this straight away, essentially. So they can come in, instead of seeing the start screen, if your users maybe feel confused by the start screen, you can actually direct them straight to this view.
Okay.
So that's another option. If we have a look at how that's done, I'll just go to the desktop here. Now, in the desktop, we can go to our properties menu again here, and we go show the apps view automatically when I go to start. So I'll click on that. And also, I can set where I want to search. So right. I can search everywhere instead of just my apps. So this will do the full Windows style, you know, the modern search. Or I can just let it search there. So if I apply this time, like I didn't do last time, we're done. Now if I hit the Windows button again, you see I come straight to the All Apps. If I go back to there, and
so
I
the
hit
start,
Windows, it's all
so
apps.
The start screen's still there, but you've taken your users to a space where they can basically see the programs that are installed for them.
Yes, exactly, exactly. And if your users are using mainly desktop apps, maybe they're coming from Windows 7 or XP and you don't want the modern apps to be at the front, maybe you want your users to use the modern apps, have that BYOD type experience.
Right.
What you can do is you can put the desktop apps first in the list. So I go like that, we'll apply that again, go back to Windows, now you see the desktop apps are first. So they see those apps that they've been using up until now, they're there. They can then scroll over and grab the other apps. So you have the two options here. It's configurable. Like we say, make the experience that you want with Windows.
So now this is something where your users can configure this for themselves, or you can give them a start in the configuration and then allow them to customize it. But there's another option as well for some organizations which want more control over the start screen and they want to prevent the users from over-customizing it and losing that that controlled environment. So, so what does that kind of an organization do if they want their users to see a standard start screen?
Yeah, let me show you something here. So I'm going to show you how you can take a layout. So we've got a start screen layout that you like. Maybe you're a call center or something like that where you really want to restrict down what the users can do. So let me open PowerShell here. I'm going to run this as administrator. And what we can do is we can export a start screen layout.
Okay.
Now, previously, the only way you could control a start screen layout was during the image engineering process. So when you built an image, you would lay out the administrator configuration. In the administrator profile, you would lay out the start menu just as you liked, and you'd use the copy profile functionality to copy it as part of the image. But this was kind of limited. You couldn't change it later on and so on. So now what we've done is we've got a couple of PowerShell commands. So if we go, if we export our layout, so we go export start layout, and then we can then choose how we want to lay it out. So as, and then we've got two options, a bin file,
okay,
which this is a file that we use when we're doing our image engineering process, or as an XML. Now you can take this XML file and put it up into group policy. Use that and apply it there. So if I go export this XML file, I'm going to export it to a path. Let's call it C: managed user.xml. So I'm going to save it there. Now, if we have a quick look at this XML file, it's actually really, really simple XML.
And this is something that you can make changes to on the fly. So next week you install or you deploy a new line of business application and you want this to appear on the start screen for all of your users. You change this XML file.
Yes.
You push it down via group policy. Your users sign in and they see this new tile on their start screen.
That's exactly right. And in the background, you see it's just a simple XML file, nothing much more than that. It tells us the size, the location, and the application that it's running.
Perfect.
So it's pretty nice and simple. So keep an eye out on that. If you want to control it, this is the way to go. Now, What you can also do is we have the opposite side of this. So if we go import start layout, we can then set the location to that layout path. So that's going to /c:// manage user XML. So we do that, and then we say a mount path. So this is where we want to inject it. Now the mount path will tell you something. You can inject this into an image that you already have using this,
right,
or you can actually just do it straight into C. So if I do that, I get an error. That's because you need to use the bin file here. So if I go back, I've already exported a bin file of my start screen layout, and go okay, now I've injected it in here. Now one thing to remember is group policy will apply it across all users and it forces it down. You can't, when they've got it, they can't change anything, and you can't apply it just once to reset it and let them go from there. It's forcing it on the machine.
Okay, so now, this is an all or nothing.
This is an all or nothing
proposition but there are organizations that want to have that tightly managed environment.
Yeah. So, and this is good for your call center, I said, that kind of place. So there's definitely a place for that. When you apply it locally like this, it affects the default user profile. So every user who logs on after that will get this setting.
Got it.
Okay. So while we're in here, I just wanted to show one other thing. Let's move that mouse. Okay, one of the things that I found, and I love the best, and often I show this to power users, is I can right-click down on the start button here. Now, I didn't right-click that time, so let's try that again. And this menu comes up. I like to call it the power menu. It's not its official name in any way, but it's for you power users who are out there, and like me, I want to come in here, and I want to do things like fire up a command prompt, or I want Task Manager to come up.
Right.
You know, these are the things I use all the time. And as IT pros, you guys are probably using this all the time as well. So there's the kind of things that you would normally have if you want to get to shutdown really quickly, it's there. So one thing I also like is I'm not a command prompt guy anymore. I like PowerShell. We've been here in PowerShell. It's powerful, as they say. So under our properties again here, you can set it so that it will go straight to PowerShell. So I can replace the command prompt with PowerShell. If we apply that and go Windows X, which is another way to get to it, you'll see I can get straight into my PowerShell command prompt.
Very nice. And a lot of options there. And most of those options, in fact, that's actually a greater selection of options on that menu than were on the old Windows 7 Start menu.
Yeah, there's certainly a lot there. And it tends to be, what we've found is these are the things that people go to the most. And it is aimed at power users. So it's the power user, the IT administrator, the sysadmin, those kind of people, these are the things they go to the most, and hence we've put them there. And I know when I've been out there showing people 8.1, I show them this, it certainly opens their eyes up a little bit.
Perfect.
Okay, so while we're in here, let's look at a couple of other options. Sometimes people get annoyed, confused by these hot corners up here. So if I go up here, you can see my mail. People might get confused. They might accidentally click on that and go into a full screen app.
And they've gone into a full screen app, and maybe, especially if they're, you know, just a frontline worker,
yeah,
they don't know how to get back to
yes,
where they were.
Yes, exactly. Okay. So we can control that experience. We'll come back to this in just a moment, Ed. Off this side, we have the charms bar. So we have those two hot corners on the top. What I can do is disable these, and this is available via group policy as well. So let's disable that. Now if I go up here, it's not there anymore, and it's not there. You can still press Windows C and see charms if you want, but they're not going to come up by touching those hot corners. So that's something you definitely want to
So from a training point
understand.
Of view,
yeah,
right, if you've got workers who are using a handful of applications during the day, most of them on the desktop, so what you've done now is you've configured this workstation so they boot straight to the desktop.
Yes.
Their most commonly used apps are already pinned to their taskbar or pinned to their default start screen, and they're not going to be confused by any of the new navigation methodologies that they have there because you've disabled those. So they're going to be pretty comfortable.
Yeah, that combined with some user training to actually show
user training
users.
Is really important.
I know, for example, I use the example of my father-in-law, who's a good example of somebody who's maybe not that literate when it comes to IT. Hopefully he's not watching this. I had to train him. I had to spend 10 minutes with him and just show him how to move screens. And hey, when a full screen app comes up, like Internet Explorer, and then you want to go back to your desktop, this is how you do it. So look, the Windows D key, it's great, try it. Or try swiping in from the side and bringing those apps across. Just a few tips you can give to your users and they will really get moving fast. And that combined with these configuration differences can really, really help a new user get up to speed.
I think one of the things that I discovered too in training people was that you need an initial session and then give them a little time to practice with it, and then a refresher a week later, and then another one a week or so after that. And in my experience, people might be a little bit confused for the first week or two, but after a few weeks, a month at the most, I found that they really take to the environment, and it isn't that difficult. But the training is the key.
Yeah, and I know with our customers that have done this, the early adopter customers, they've used, small videos they send out and tips and tricks and that kind of stuff. Here's an email with a link to a video. So, hey, click this. People can find their way to our email. Click this, and it will launch up and say, here's some tips. Here's how you swipe from the side, those kind of things. And it really does increase productivity for users extremely quickly.
Now, in Windows 8.1, you have right on the desktop some help and tips. An application.
Yeah, there's a help and tips app.
There's some video, there's some tutorials and stuff. That was not in Windows 8, but if you have a new user and they're not scheduled for their formal training session yet, you can send them to this and they can learn some of the basics of navigating the Windows 8.1 user experience.
Exactly,
right?
Exactly. Okay. And this has proved to be very helpful for our early adopter users as well.
So. Okay. Now, I notice you have... you have a couple of screens there, and I have on my desktop at home, I have at any given time, I have 2, 3, or 4 monitors. And I know one of the things about Windows 8.1 that I have been delighted by is the support for is some of the improvements in multi-monitor support. So can we talk through some of those?
Yeah, so one of the first things you can do is control where your taskbar is or how your taskbar is displayed. You can display it across all the monitors. I'm not in a multi-monitor setup now, but on the on our demo machine here, on the first taskbar navigation, you will see an area that allows you to control what's going where the start screen pops up. So whether the start screen pops up on the screen you're using or on your main screen, you have that option to control that.
And you can have the taskbar on both screens.
Goes across the bottom. I'm like you, I have a multi-monitor setup. I have 2 large monitors, and then I have my laptop down below. And so I have my taskbar across all of those. And
one of the big issues with multi-monitor support, especially with this new class of devices that we have, you've got a Surface Pro 2 there, and that has a small screen, 10.6-inch screen, I think, but it's 1920 by 1080. It's a full high definition screen. And so you have to do some scaling on that so that, because otherwise when you go to the desktop on a screen that's that small with that high of a resolution, the type that you see is going to be about this big. So you have to do some scaling. But now if you plug an external monitor, say a big 27-inch monitor into that, it used to be that you had to choose one scaling for both of those. And so you either had to have little tiny type on your small screen that looked good on the big screen, or something that you could read on the small screen that looked gigantic on the large screen. You've changed that, right?
Yeah, and the Surface Pro is a good example. I've attempted to to run my Surface Pro at a lower resolution than the 150% scaling that it comes with. It just does get too hard on the eye. So what we do is on the demo machine here, I'm in the screen resolution setting, you will all know that. If you click advanced settings, I always go there. If you click, well, I can't see this on here because we don't have multi-monitor plugged in. But what you can do, actually we click on this one. I was clicking on the wrong thing there. Okay,
perfect.
So you can see my scaling here is larger at 150%. If I have multiple monitors on there, you'll be able to choose across the different monitors what size you want. So if you have a big 27-inch like I have on my desk, I have that at 100% scaling.
Exactly.
On my Surface Pro, definitely 150%. Otherwise, it is unusable. So adjust, as Ed said, for what you need.
Yeah, that's perfect. Now, there are a lot of new devices that are available for Windows 8.1, new form factors. Now, one of the things when I was researching this, one of the big changes that happened between Windows 8 and Windows 8.1 was a change in the minimum supported resolution for the operating system. In Windows 8, you had to have 1366 by 768 at a minimum. Anything less than that, and you couldn't do the snap behavior and things like that. But with Windows 8.1, you can now have small devices with lower resolutions.
Yes.
And they'll still
and
work.
Still snap. Yeah.
So for example, I have this this 8-inch tablet.
Valve. Yeah.
Which is, you know, it was a marvelous little device. This is a 1280 by 800 resolution, and it would not have been supported under Windows 8. I mean, I could have made something appear there, but I could have only used one app at a time. But this now behaves differently, right?
Yeah, and I guess as we get these new devices, there is going to be a range of resolutions. You've got the big monitor where you might want to have 10 apps across the screen with the new Windows Store-style applications. Or the small one here, where you might want to have just one, or maybe split it across the screen. So you can split your two apps across the screen. And I know I've had, on my monitors at home, 5 or 6 apps across there. More for testing purposes, I tend to only use 2. But, you know, you want to try and see how many you can get. But certainly that's a better experience.
So one of the things that's possible in those scenarios, and one of the changes that you've made in the user experience here, is that change in the snap experience. So in Windows 8, you had the option to put just a narrow band of you could put two apps on the screen, but one was just in a narrow band on the side. That's changed also, right?
Yeah. So on the demo machine here, you can see I've got my mail open. This is my junk mail by the look of it. I'm in the newsletters folder there, and the mail client, you know, the new apps are great. I love this new mail client. I use it when I'm at home. I use Outlook when I'm actually in the office. I use this when I'm at home, get up in the morning or lying in bed. I use this. Okay, so let's say now I want to open up a new app. So I'm going back there. Let's open the weather, for example. I've got that, and now I want to pull in my mail again. Let's pop that over here. So you can see it split half and half. Previously, it was like 2/3, 1/3. Type sizing,
right.
But I can grab that here and I can move it and it will adjust the display. So I can move it to whatever size I want to. So you've got that scaling, you can adjust it just how you want. You might want to browse and put your Twitter feed down the side or your Facebook or whatever it might be if that's what you want to do. So on your, especially as you get to that tablet type experience, this is awesome. You know, it's, you can adjust it how you want, and okay, this screen's a bit smaller that I have here, but if I had a larger screen, I would throw extra apps on there as well.
And by the way, we were talking about multiple monitors before, but you also have the option, if you have multiple monitors, you can have a desktop on both displays, on one display,
yes.
On part of each display.
Yeah,
even.
Exactly. You can put it wherever you want, really.
Yeah.
Previously, you had to have your apps on one and your desktop on another. There wasn't the control there with Windows 8, but now you have a lot more control. There's a lot more options, and we go back to the kind of mantra I'm saying, which is we want to give you the experience you want and the control of that experience. So, yeah. One thing I didn't show before, which I feel remiss on doing, is if we go, let's go back to the desktop here and we'll go back to our settings. One thing that if you want people to have the start screen and you want that experience to be not so jarring between the desktop and the start screen, is you can set your desktop wallpaper as the background. Now, this is something I wanted right in the beginning, and okay, we've got it now. But if we look at that now, I'm going to apply that setting, and I go Windows, you can see there's my desktop background. If I bring the desktop and bring up the start screen, it's really not so jarring. It doesn't feel like you're going to a whole nother world for the users. And especially when you're on the start screen and that is quite different, it will feel much more natural to them. And as they start to use it, maybe they do start on this All Apps view, but after a while, they might want to make the machine theirs a little bit more and see their weather, these kind of things. And they'll see it here. One thing I do in the morning is I get up and look at the share price for starters. I hope it's going up. It's gone down a little today. And the weather and so on. I cycle to work a lot of the time, so I look up and see, oh, it's 10 degrees. I'm going to put on my long gear or whatever it might be. So yeah, this is definitely a great experience there.
Great. That's fantastic. So that's the Windows 8.1 user experience. A lot of changes, many of them aimed at making the environment more customizable and more comfortable for the users that you're supporting, but also a lot of tools for you to help deploy that environment out to the users that you have. And that makes your training job a lot easier as well, right?
Yeah, exactly. It is going to be a lot easier. We have all the traditional management style tools, the Microsoft Deployment Toolkit, Configuration Manager, that kind of thing. Michael and others will talk about that later on in the day. So those original tools you have are there, along with the ability to control all this stuff via group policy, for example, forcing the start screen that we mentioned, setting the all apps view, that kind of stuff is all available to you to adjust for your users.
Great. Now we're going to shift gears at this point. We're going to move to Internet Explorer 11. And Internet Explorer 11 is a standard feature of Windows 8.1. Now Windows 8, when it came out, included Internet Explorer 10. So Internet Explorer 11 is a basic part of the operating system. We're going to have Fred Pullen from the Internet Explorer team joining us shortly. What I want to do right now is talk about a couple of little housekeeping details for our full day. First of all, I want to make a plug for my new book, Introducing Windows 8.1 for IT Professionals. It's free in ebook formats. You can get it as a PDF, as an EPUB format that will work with all sorts of standard reader devices, and as a MOBI format that will work with Kindles. And then later on during the day, we're going to be going through four more sessions. Before the meal break, after we finish here, we're going to take a slight break, and then we're going to be talking about security. Then we'll be taking a meal break, and we'll have three sessions after that. One on deployment, one on mobility, where we'll be talking about some really interesting new technologies like Miracast and NFC. And finally, we'll be talking about mobile device management. These are all topics that are near and dear to the hearts of IT pros, and so I hope you'll stick around for those. But right now, I want to give the stage to Fred Pullen from the Internet Explorer team, who's going to talk to us about Internet Explorer 11.
Thank you, Ed. Hi, everyone. I hope you're having a great day. So, taking a step back, Internet Explorer 11 is a browser that's fast, furious, and perfect for touch. Fast, fluid, and perfect for touch. And but that's for consumers. I also want to talk about what we do for enterprise customers and commercial customers. So it seems like there's a natural tension in the ecosystem between wanting to take the web forward with modern standards and wanting to provide better backward compatibility for existing web apps. And so I get a lot of questions about Internet Explorer 10 and now Internet Explorer 11 having two different experiences. We have the immersive full-screen browser, but we also have a legacy browser for the desktop. And so if you look at it, there's this natural tension between needing to support modern standards, touch devices, great new form factors, and at the same time needing to provide better backward compatibility. What we've done in IE10 and now IE11 is to provide a user experience for each of those. We have an immersive browser that's full screen, perfect for touch. It's by default runs in enhanced protected mode, so it's a little more secure, 64-bit memory space. And at the same time, we still have the legacy desktop experience. This is more compatible with ActiveX controls, for example. So by providing an experience for each, we're trying to be the best of both worlds, to both take the web forward with modern standards and to have a great backward compatible experience. Now, one other thing I should mention is IE11 came out recently for Windows 7 as well. Obviously, on Windows 7, we just have the legacy desktop browser, but there are significant improvements under the hood. So on both editions of IE11 for Windows 8.1 and for Windows 7, we have significant improvements in terms of additional standard support, HTML5, CSS3, WebGL now with 2D and 3D transforms. We also have security improvements. We also have performance improvements, faster JavaScript engine, and so on.
So if if someone is in an environment, as a lot of the members of our audience I'm sure are, where they're primarily using Windows 7 but migrating over time to Windows 8.1, you're going to have a mixed environment. You're going to have Windows 8.1 machines and Windows 7. You can take all of them and put them all on Internet Explorer 11. What are the differences going to be between the users on Windows 7 and Windows 8.1, besides obviously the lack of support for the immersive environment?
No, that's a great question. We realize we have a lot of customers, for example, who were on Windows XP and moved from IE6 to IE8 because it helped them move up to a more modern version of Windows. They could stay on IE8 and move to Windows 7, for example. So in a similar manner, we have a lot of Windows 7 customers now who are moving up to IE11 to help ease their migration up to Windows 8.1. So the essential difference is, as you mentioned, the modern browser.
Right.
Compatibility for their existing apps, they should be able to test against IE11 on Windows 7 and be assured that investment will translate to their Windows 8.1 migration.
So you mentioned the word compatibility, and that's a really, really important one. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of the pain points that people have out there when they use Internet Explorer are they're dealing with websites that are designed, more or less hard-coded, to behave in a specific way when they encounter Internet Explorer. They say, oh, you're from Internet Explorer, we're going to show you the experience that we built in 2005. Right? I mean, that's basically the way that a lot of sites work. And I've noticed in using Internet Explorer 11 on Windows 8.1 that one of the things that I've been used to seeing the last couple years, that little compatibility box in the address bar, it's not there anymore, is it?
It's not there anymore, but we still have compatibility view, and it's still available for enterprise customers, commercial customers to use. Okay. Let me explain. Starting in around IE8, we had compatibility modes for previous versions of Internet Explorer. So in IE11, we actually have compatibility modes, or what we call document modes, for IE10, IE9, IE8, IE7, and even something called Quirks mode for previous versions. In addition to all those modes, we actually have a Quirks mode that's very similar to the Quirks mode in other browsers.
Right.
So the good news is we do have these compatibility modes and compatibility view. Compatibility view, to answer your question, still exists. It's just that we found a lot of users tended to misuse it. Because there was a button on the address bar, they tended to click it. We've buried it a little bit, and I'll show you in a second. We actually just put that on the drop-down menu. So now you can open up the compatibility view dialog box, and I'll show you, it's very, still very easy to add a site to that compatibility view.
And there's also there's a standard compatibility list that Microsoft publishes, just as they have for the last couple versions of Internet Explorer, so that if there's well-known sites out there that need to be told how, which version of Internet Explorer to target, that's done on a list. And that list is enabled by default?
Yes, it is. Okay. So let's talk at a, since you brought up compatibility, let's talk at a broad level about the tools that are available to kind of troubleshoot and help with compatibility. And then I'll dive into some of the consumer-facing features of Internet Explorer 11.
Okay.
All right. So at a broad level, we do have what you just mentioned is the compatibility view list. This is a public-facing XML file that essentially declares the document mode for a particular website. So if we work with a developer, for example, they may request that their site be put in IE8 mode temporarily while they upgrade to modern standards. This is, again, a public-facing compatibility view list. It's an XML file. It's different for each version of the browser, but it is pulled down from Microsoft, and it's dynamically updated by default. Of course, administrators can control all this through group policy, so they can turn it off, turn it on, you know, according to their needs. We also have, for developers, an XUA-compatible meta tag that they can add to any web app that they manage. And the XUA-compatible tag can explicitly declare which of those modes I mentioned earlier, which of the document modes to use. We do have a couple of group policies as well. The group policies today exist for IE7 mode, document mode, and also for quirks mode. And again, by default, intranet sites are set in this compatibility view by default.
Right.
At some point, we think that our customers will be ready to have us flip the switch and have the default be a more modern standards mode. Today, most of our customers are telling us that they do want that compatibility view for some time. While they continue to upgrade their applications.
But for the most part, if in your organization you have websites that you're building, internal or external facing, there's all sorts of guidance out there. You should basically assume that this is one of the most standards compatible browsers out there, and you should just write good standards compatible code and let it render in Internet Explorer 11. Don't try and change things, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And that actually is a good segue. I can show you something we've done with the user agent string that is a significant change that IT pros should at least be aware of on behalf of their developer counterparts. So I'm switching over here, and we're going to pull up a website.
So now we're in, so this is the immersive browser.
This is the immersive browser. And what I'm pulling up now is a third-party website called myuseragent.com. And what you see here is this user agent string is unlike earlier versions of Internet Explorer 11. This is what the web app uses sometimes to decide what code to send back to a particular browser. What we've done here is we've made a significant change in IE 11 to say not IE 11 or a previous string, but we actually say RV 11 like Gecko. What we're trying to do, to your point earlier, what we're trying to do now is get websites to give us modern standard code.
Right.
What we found was for IE 10, a lot of websites were hard-coded to say, oh, you're running Internet Explorer? Let me give you the code I wrote for Internet Explorer 8.
Right.
And in the meantime, other browsers were being rendered, modern standards-based code.
Now, Gecko is the rendering engine for Mozilla's Firefox.
I believe so.
It is. Yeah. So what you're basically saying is that is among web developers, that is considered an HTML standard. And so if they see Gecko in there, they're going to say, oh, okay, we can deliver our standards-compliant code to it. We won't try and mess with it. What you're really trying to prevent here is something called browser sniffing, right?
Right.
I mean, so what browser sniffing happens when I visit a web page and it says and it tries to figure out what browser I'm using and then send me what it thinks I want. And with Internet Explorer 11, it's likely going to guess wrong if it's sniffing just the browser name. So you got a better chance of succeeding in getting a modern, standards compliant, good looking page this way.
That's absolutely true for public facing websites. But again, for internal web apps, they may have been written for a specific version of Internet Explorer, which is why I wanted to bring up this view. If I go into the F12 developer tools, if I press F12 here, you'll see that I have some tools down at the bottom, and I can make this window a good bit bigger. I can go into the last tab here, and actually, for testing purposes, I can set it manually in a different document mode. So at this point, I can choose to say, let's set this in IE8 mode, and you'll see if we refresh this. Let's see here. Switching back to my browser. If I set this in IE8 mode, let's go. Sorry, I'm having a bit of trouble with the function keys here. There we go.
So you're trying to show what the new user agent string is going to look like once you've used the F12.
That's right.
Functions to change the string that's sent to the website.
That's right. And I'm just changing, I changed it to pin it down here.
Okay.
And if I change this to be something like IE9 mode, or IE8 mode, IE7 mode, it should show us different user agent strings.
You need to refresh the...
Yeah, I think it refreshed. Oh, well, that's okay. I can also change the user agent string manually to be something like IE8. And you'll see here, it now is showing MSIE 8.0, Trident 4.0, which is what a web app would expect to see from Internet Explorer 8, for example.
Okay, so these are features that two types of users can use. You, as a power user or an IT pro, might want to use those F12 compatibility tools on a daily basis to deal with websites that need to be fooled into rendering properly, but you can also use this for your general users, right?
Yes, and the reason I wanted to show IT pros in particular is this is an easy step that you can do to troubleshoot a particular web app, and then you can go back to the developers and say, I think your site renders best in IE8 mode, or I think your site renders best in IE9 mode. Can you please add that XUA compatible tag and make it very easy to troubleshoot some of these issues?
Okay, so why don't we switch gears and talk about some of the user experience features that users are likely to see when they're using Internet Explorer 11.
Absolutely. So let's dive back into the start screen here. And what you'll notice here is that on our start screen, we have tiles. Some of them are for Internet Explorer sites. Some of them are for web apps, and we're really mingling the two. Internet Explorer 11 is fast, fluid, and perfect for touch. And what we see here is we have live tiles connecting to atari.com/arcade, modern.ie, and a game called Contre Jour. And what we find is if I click on Contre Jour, for example, it'll take us out to this game, and you'll see it's very... You know, it's very fluid. I can go ahead and start a particular level. It's loading.
And so you're going to lose a whole lot of productivity today trying to get up to level 10 on this game.
No, that's right. One other thing I wanted to show here, and while that's coming up, I can bring up another website to show you, and that's ie.microsoft.com. And I'll come back to Contre Jour a different way, but I wanted to show you a couple of resources here. One is ie.microsoft.com is the best site to go to show consumers what the new version of Internet Explorer can do.
Okay.
And it has a lot of resources. I'm not sure if I've lost my connectivity, but that's okay.
Okay, so for anyone who is who has installed the Windows 8.1 update or who has purchased a new device that has Windows 8.1 pre-installed, they don't need to do anything special. Internet Explorer 11 is already there.
That's correct.
And that's true for, and if somebody's running Windows 8, the way to get Internet Explorer 11 is to update to Windows 8.1.
That's correct.
And for people who are, for machines that are still on Windows 7, there is a separate download that they'll need to install, and that can be pushed via Windows Update and such.
Yes, they can go and download it today via Microsoft Downloads for Windows 7, or they can wait and receive it as part of the automatic updates package.
Okay. Can you tell me a little something about Enhanced Protected Mode and what that does and how that works?
Yes, absolutely.
Might not be able to show it, but at least we can talk about it.
All right, it looks like this website came up. What we have here is ie.microsoft.com. This is where I would send consumers who are interested in learning more about the browser. You can click to see what's new, and it will show you browsing basics, some of the features I'm going to show in a few minutes.
Okay.
All right, talking about Enhanced Protected Mode. Enhanced Protected Mode is essentially a sandboxed mode that by default runs 64-bit. It also is plug-in free browsing. So thanks to modern standards like HTML5, CSS3, WebGL, there's a lot you can do within the browser. You can create 2D and 3D experiences. You can create a lot of multimedia, very rich, rich multimedia experiences without relying on plugins. And as all of us know, plugins are often a source of some of these vulnerabilities and exploits.
Right.
So by relying on modern standards like HTML5, CSS3, WebGL, you can create these experiences and really kind of sidestep some of those security vulnerabilities. We also, by default, in enhanced protected mode, will run 64-bit memory space. The 64-bit memory space gives us more memory to play with. So we have memory protections, for example, high entropy address space layout randomization, which is basically randomizing where in memory a particular process starts. Thanks to the 64-bit memory space, we actually have over a terabyte of addressable memory where we can start a process.
Yikes.
So we're not making heap spraying attacks impossible, but we're making heap spraying attacks where someone inserts their code at just the right spot. We're making that very, very improbable.
And even if I can succeed in doing that, the likelihood is that I won't be able to reuse that same exploit on a different machine. Because it's going to be going into a different address space.
Absolutely, that's the idea.
All right, you got that working again?
Let's see some more
of those features.
So if we go to ie.microsoft.com/test-drive, this is a great site that shows off some showcase websites for Internet Explorer, including Contre-Jour that I was just showing, TouchFX, Hover. I wanted to show everybody this because this is an example of some of the experiences that you can create now through HTML5 and CSS3.
I'm getting flashbacks. Isn't this from way back?
This is actually a Windows 95 game
we
reimagined and are now offering through the web. So you can play this single player or you can set up a multiplayer game with up to 8 of your friends. And if we go into single player, the nice thing here is I can interact
with
the
device. That's the code name for Windows 95.
Code name for Windows 95 was Chicago, absolutely. Now, the nice thing is Bambi, if you here's a tip for our audience. I could play this, and it shows how interactive you can play this with your keyboard and mouse, or you can play this with your touch screen. So I can navigate through here. You'll see that it's pretty fast. Actually, it's faster than I am at this point. But I also wanted to show you briefly an Easter egg. If you're at this home screen and you type Bambi, B-A-M-B-I, actually, I might have to reload it to start it over, B-A-M-B-I, it's actually going to drop into 8-bit Windows 95 style graphics, including the ability to tweet and share this via Facebook, but Windows 95 style. So tweet.exe.
So it's it's basically a time machine for our viewers. We need to take a 10-minute break now. And there's lots of stuff in Internet Explorer 11 that people should explore. I know one of my favorite features in it is the ability in the modern browser to make the taskbar and tabs always visible along the bottom, and that's a really neat feature for power users who don't have to try and figure out where those tabs have gone to. Thanks very much, Fred, for talking to us there. Like I said, we're going to take a 10-minute break right now, and when we come back, we're going to be talking about security in Windows 8.1.
Thanks, Ed. Thank you, everyone.